Dear students, in this lesson, we learn aspects related to teaching, learning and assessment. Teaching, learning and assessment are aspects of the curriculum for which teachers take responsibility. It is important that teachers should have understanding of these aspects. Let us discuss the definitions of these concepts. Teaching can be defined as engagement with the learners to enable their understanding and application of knowledge, concepts and processes. It includes design, content selection, delivery of instruction, assessment and reflection. Teaching here means engaging students in learning. Thus, teaching consists of getting students involved in the active construction of knowledge. A teacher requires not only knowledge of subject matter, but knowledge of how students learn and how to transform them into active learners. The aim of teaching is not only to transmit information, but also to transform students from passive recipients to active constructors of their own and others' knowledge. The teacher cannot transform without the students' active participation. Teaching is fundamentally about creating the pedagogical, social, and ethical conditions under which students agree to take charge of their own learning individually and collectively. Learning can be defined as the activity or process of gaining knowledge or skill by studying, practicing, being taught, or experiencing something. Learning is about what students do, not about what we as teachers do. Assessment is defined as the act of judging the amount of learning that took place as a result of learning and teaching. The methods of learning are crucial for learning, and the method of teaching is termed as pedagogy. There are certain principles involved in the methods and activities of the practice of teaching. Let us discuss each principle in detail. Principle 1. The learning environment is productive and supportive. The teacher builds positive relationship with and values each student. Through teacher modeling and classroom strategies based on cooperation and mutual support, an environment is created where students feel comfortable to pursue inquiries and express themselves. They take responsibility for their learning and are prepared to pursue and try out new ideas. This component is about building quality relationship based on respect, value and care. It is about taking time to get to know and understand students in an educational sense, but also in a wider social and personal sense. The teacher promotes a culture of value and respect for individuals and their communities. This component is about creating an environment where students' comments are acknowledged, their different opinions respected, cultural and other differences are accepted, and where students feel safe and valued. Students being supported to feel confident to contribute ideas without fear of being put down. The principle 2, that learning environment promotes self-motivation, independence and interdependence. Teachers model practices that build independence and motivate students to work in an autonomous manner. Students are involved in decision making within the classroom in relation to what and how they learn, and they are encouraged to take responsibility for their learning. Team building skills are also explicitly taught so that students learn to collaborate, negotiate, and contribute to joint assignments and experience the sharing of roles, responsibilities, and ownership. The teacher encourages and supports students to take responsibility for their learning. The component involves structuring learning experiences and providing support and scaffolding to enable students to make choices and take responsibility for their learning. It also involves a focus on students understanding themselves as learners and is facilitated by clear, transparent, criteria-based and often collaborative assessment processes. The teacher uses strategies that build skills required for productive collaboration. This component involves students collaborating on meaningful tasks and responses to questions. Principle 3. Students' needs and interests are reflected in the learning program. A range of strategies is used to monitor and respond to students' different learning needs, social needs, and cultural perspectives. Students' lives and interests are reflected in the learning sequences. A variety of teaching strategies are used to accommodate the range of abilities and interests and to encourage diversity and autonomy. Teaching strategies are flexible and responsive to the values, needs, and interests of individual students. This component acknowledges that the classroom should be an interesting place and suited to a wide range of dispositions. A range of students' competencies and potential for future learning may be untapped in classrooms. This emphasizes the need to provide opportunities for these to be displayed. Hence, the teacher utilizes a range of teaching strategies that support different ways of thinking and learning. Principle 4. Teaching sequences promote sustained learning that builds over time and emphasizes connections between ideas. This component involves running with ideas for sufficient time to examine and use them in depth. This applies to the way key ideas are built across a learning sequence, but might also mean having sufficient time in teaching sessions to properly examine ideas. Links are made across subject areas to demonstrate relevance and concreteness with what is being taught and how key ideas can apply to a range of situations. The teacher emphasizes the quality of learning with high expectations of achievement. Teachers need to clarify, signal an expectation that students will achieve at a high level and put in effort to produce quality work. This also involves teachers expressing and demonstrating confidence that students are capable of significant achievement. There is structured support to help students learn effectively so that this expectation does not occur in a vacuum. The teacher uses strategies that challenge and support students to question and reflect. This component involves the development of learning tasks designed to encourage and support students to move beyond their current understandings and think more deeply about ideas and practice. Teacher questions are open-ended and designed to promote depth and breadth of knowledge and understanding. Teachers emphasize engagement with ideas and practice through exploration. The teacher uses strategies to develop investigating and problem-solving skills. This component refers to higher-order thinking skills that may be described in various ways but encompass such things such as interpretation, analysis, and application. It refers to development of knowledge of ways of reasoning with evidence particular to the discipline area. These skills and knowledge are needed to successfully solve problems. The teacher uses strategies to foster imagination and creativity. Principle 5. Assessment practices are an integral part of teaching and learning. Assessment contributes to planning at a number of levels. Monitoring of student learning is continuous and encompasses a variety of aspects of understanding and practice. Assessment criteria are explicit and feedback is designed to support students' further learning and encourage them to monitor and take responsibility for their own learning. Principle 6. Learning connects strongly with the communities and practice beyond the classroom students' learning needs to connect with their current and future lives and with the contemporary thinking in the broader community. A variety of links are made between the classroom program and the local and the broader community, leading to students developing a rich view of knowledge and practice, including social and ethical issues. The teacher uses technologies in ways that reflect professional and community practices. New technology challenges and changes the way we behave and learn in our contemporary society. Learners need to develop a mastery of contemporary skills and techniques and their application through new media and new technologies. When used in ways that reflect their contemporary use, learning technologies can provide powerful stimulus for students to operate autonomously and develop expertise. Learners use a range of learning technologies to create new knowledge and understandings. These principles will help the teachers build consistent, comprehensive, and improved pedagogical approaches, and it allows flexibility, innovation, and local decision making at the school level. It will help focused teaching to meet the diverse needs of students. It will strengthen learning communities within and beyond the school. Now let us learn the principles of learning. Learning is not necessarily an outcome of teaching. Cognitive research is revealing that even with what is taken to be good instruction, many students, including academically talented ones, understand less than we think they do. With determination, students taking an examination are commonly able to identify what they have been told or what they have read. Careful probing, however, often shows that their understanding is limited or distorted, if not altogether wrong. This finding suggests that parsimony is essential in setting out educational goals. School should pick the most important concepts and skills to emphasize so that they can concentrate on the quality of understanding rather than the quantity of information presented. The other principle is that what students learn is influenced by their existing ideas. People have to construct their own meaning regardless of how clearly teachers or books tell them things. Mostly, a person does this by connecting new information and concepts to what he or she already believes. Concepts, the essential units of human thought that do not have multiple links with how a student thinks about the world, are not likely to be remembered or useful. But effective learning often requires more than just making multiple connections of new ideas to old ones. It sometimes requires that people restructure their thinking radically. That is, to incorporate some new idea, learners must change the connections among the things they already know, or even discard some long-held beliefs about the world. Students come to school with their own ideas, some correct, some not, about almost every topic they are likely to encounter. If their intuition and misconceptions are ignored or dismissed out of hand, their original beliefs are likely to win out in the long run. More contradiction is not sufficient. Students must be encouraged to develop new views by seeing how such views help them make better sense of the world. The other important principle in learning is that progression in learning is usually from the concrete to the abstract. Young people can learn mostly readily about things that are tangible and directly accessible to their sense, visual, auditory, tactile, and kinesthetic. With experience, they grow in their ability to understand abstract concepts, manipulate symbols, reason logically, and generalize. These skills develop slowly, however, and the dependence of most people on concrete examples of new ideas persist throughout life. Concrete experiences are most effective in learning when they occur in the context of some relevant conceptual structure. The difficulties many students have in grasping abstractions are often masked by their ability to remember and recite technical terms that they do not understand. As a result, teachers from kindergarten to college sometimes overestimate the ability of their students to handle abstractions, and they take the students' use of the right words as evidence of understanding. The other principle is people learn to do well only what they practice doing. If students are expected to apply ideas in novel situations, then they must practice applying them in novel situations. If they practice only calculating answers to predictable exercises or unrealistic word problems, then that is all they are likely to learn. Similarly, students cannot learn to think critically, analyze information, communicate specific ideas, make logical arguments, work as part of a team, and acquire other desirable skills unless they are permitted and encouraged to do those things over and over in many contexts. Effective learning by students require feedback. Learning often takes place best when students have opportunities to express ideas and get feedback from their peers. But for feedback to be most helpful to learners, it must consist of more than the provision of correct answers. Feedback ought to be analytical, to be suggestive, and to come at a time when students are interested in it. And then there must be time for students to reflect on the feedback they receive, to make adjustment and try again. This is a requirement that is neglected. It is worth noting by most examinations, especially finals. According to Anne Gravels, there are 5 stages of teacher training cycle. These include identifying needs, planning and designing, delivering, assessing and evaluating. The teacher's training cycle starts with identifying needs. This stage is about identifying 3 basic needs: needs of the organization, identifying your own needs as a teacher, and identifying the needs of your learners. The needs of the organization would mean the curriculum requirement, awarding body preference, and or other qualification needs. The needs of the teacher would include the understanding of the qualification requirements, find out how you would deliver, the resources that are available to you, and even the room that you will be delivering the sessions in. The third need is that of the learner. It is important to identify the needs of the learner so that you can address it throughout the course. Hopefully, you will be able to find these out of the interview stage or the admission stage. The learner needs at the stage would range from very basic questions like how to get to the venue, how to reach the classroom, where do I park the car or vehicle, etc. Initial assessment starts at the beginning, as the name suggests. This is usually at the beginning of the program so that you can find out all about your learner. Diagnostic assessment is about diagnosing the special needs of your learner, learning styles of your learner, and any prior learning that the learner may have. You can do this through an initial interview or a learning preference questionnaire. This stage should be essential if a student may want financial assistance, and you could guide them to an agency organization that would help them with the funding. However, to identify the needs correctly, the teacher ought to plan and design her lesson carefully. After identifying the needs, it's important to plan and design the learner's delivery and the content as well. This will eventually make the teachers efficient and the learning process effective. What do you mean by planning learning? You need to plan how you will deliver the learning, how they will learn, and how you will assess your students. A scheme of work is a document that has a logical flow of what you will cover in the sessions, the activities, the delivery methods, the assessment methods, learning outcomes, aims and objectives of the lesson, and who your learners are. A scheme of work can further be divided into individual lesson plans for each lesson. Each lesson plan will outline details of learners, the resources you will need, the outcomes, the assessment and timings of the session. This lesson plan is a more detailed version of the scheme of work. It is important to note that when planning, the teacher needs to plan each activity, resources, delivery method and assessment in order to meet the needs of the students that were identified during the first stage of the teacher training cycle. Delivering the lesson requires adhering to the lesson plan that contains details of learning styles for all individuals. In order to keep the learning process effective, the teacher must refer back to the lesson plan, refer to examples, provide guidance, use teaching assistants, and should timely check the understanding of students by asking questions in the middle of the lesson. However, in order to make delivering of the lesson effective, the classroom environment should be welcoming and helpful. Delivery methods may include lectures, presentations, verbal lectures and demonstrations, ice breaks, etc. It is important that the delivery methods keep the learners active, engaged and motivated, and the delivery methods cater to the individual needs of the students. Assessing ensures that the lesson taught to students have been delivered effectively and whether there is a gap between the explanation and the understanding of the lesson. Assessment can be done through three ways, which are initial, formative and summative. Formative assessment include quizzes, assignments and projects. Summative assessments include an exam, project, case study at the end of the term that must be completed in order to achieve the qualification or passing mark. The teacher needs to ensure that the assessments are valid, authentic, current, sufficient and reliable. Valid means the work should only assess what is meant to assess. Authentic means produced by the learner. Current means the student should have current knowledge and skills to complete the assessment. Sufficient here means is there enough evidence provided that the learner can complete the assessment. Reliable here means is the assessment reliable. If you do the same assessment with a different group of learners, would you get similar results? The teacher should not be biased toward any student during the checking of the assessment, as the planning and designing part of the cycle should include the learning methods that cater to the individual needs of the students. Evaluate means evaluating learning and teaching. In the evaluating phase, the teacher or the school management should ask for feedback from the students about the lesson, which will be helpful for the teacher to plan the future lesson and to eliminate the explanation gaps, teaching methodologies, the delivery and all the other stages of the training cycle. Moreover, the feedback will not only help the teachers in professional development, it will also help the students to improve their critical thinking skills and learn to give constructive feedback. The feedback process can be done through making the students fill an evaluation form with close-ended questions and a feedback box at the end of the form. Adding more, the teachers will be able to judge effectiveness of their planned lesson and its content. An assessment component of this stage is self-evaluation by the teacher. Reflecting upon your own teaching will help you improve further your teaching style. This is also known as continuing professional development. CPD helps in maintaining, improving and broadening your knowledge and skills for developing personal qualities required in your professional lives. This can be done through attending a workshop and taking short courses. Feedback should also be given to the students so that they are aware of where they lacked and how they can further improve themselves. This can be done through handing out monthly progress reports to students and for their parents to see which area the child is lacking in. Thus, to conclude that teaching, learning and assessment are aspects of the curriculum for which teachers take responsibility. Thank you, students, for your kind attention.